In 1935, when a false rumor spread through Harlem that a boy had been shot and killed for shoplifting, a riot erupted which lasted for 2 days. In a series of articles in the New York Post, Powell established himself as the voice of Harlem's despair. Have you ever eaten garbage? Dined on bones sucked dry by strangers' mouths? Bread soaked in the juices of a garbage can? It was not a riot, he wrote. It was an open, unorganized protest against empty stomachs, overcrowded tenements, filthy sanitation, rotten foodstuffs, and chiseling landlords. It was not caused by communists.
The Uptown Chamber of Commerce at that particular time had not only no black members, but blacks weren't even allowed to have stores on 125th Street.
In the Harlem community, black girls could not get a job as clerks in the 10-cent stores.
Adam thought that this was a good place to start and accomplish two things. Get jobs for some people and establish himself as a hero and a fighter for black rights. Beautiful combination.
You had an extraordinary explosion. And here was this very articulate, 6'4", handsome guy parading up and down 125th Street with his congregation. He would have his church people, those women, most of those pickets in the street were women.
Under the banner, "Don't buy where you can't work," Powell helped establish picket lines from river to river along 125th Street. By that afternoon, the stores were closed.
Bloomsteins, Woolworths, Kress, many jewelry and department stores on 125th Street were now in a position where they were forced to have to hire.
Powell smashed barriers to black employment in the telephone company and the power company, in the baking, pharmaceutical, and beverage industries, and at the 1939 World's Fair. In 1941, he was a leader of the nation's first racially motivated bus boycott, declaring that every Negro that rides a bus is lynching the Negro race. Powell secured jobs for black drivers and mechanics in New York's public transportation system.
He gave courage and leadership to a people who were hungering for someone to enunciate their feelings, their grief. And that was the grip he had on them.
To understand Powell is to understand how the black church could be used as it would later be used in the 1950s and the 1960s. And in that sense, he's an antecedent to the civil rights movement, but far more than an antecedent. He was an individual who demonstrated the power of the church as a protest instrument, the power of the church as a social instrument, the power of the church as a community organizing instrument, and the power of the church as a political instrument.
Everything that we are about as African people in terms of our struggle for justice and freedom started in the church. There is no separation of the sacred and secular of church and state. In black America, there is no separation.
In 1941, Powell launched a newspaper, The People's Voice, as a forum for his views, and was elected to the New York City Council, the first black ever to hold the office. By the age of 32, Adam Powell was pastor of a 14,000-member church and leader of a mass movement which had obtained jobs for hundreds of Negroes. As a city councilman, he had all the publicity and prestige that went with the office, and his newspaper reached those thousands beyond political life. He was ready for bigger things. A new congressional district had been created for Harlem. It was an opportunity he couldn't ignore. At a rally at Madison Square Garden, black union leader A. Philip Randolph was expected to announce for the seat. Powell dropped a bomb on the massive crowd.
Adam announced at that convention that he was a candidate for Congress. Upheaval. It was upheaval. Because they knew that that he couldn't be defeated in Harlem.
He was a rascal, I'm telling you. But he had charm. He had, no question, he had charisma. And he had that community in the palm of his hand. He really did.
He didn't want to be called Reverend at that time. Just called me Adam. And all the kids and all, you see him on the streets, they say, hello, Adam. They were crazy about him. Well, all you could hear was Adam, Adam.
The black preacher is preeminently a prince, the better ones. They are accustomed to parishioner adulation. And if they're good, they are, it's just superb. And this man was superb.
Powell won the nomination of the Liberal, Democratic, and Republican parties. On Election Day 1944, he was swept into office, the first black man ever to sit in Congress from any of the northeastern United States.
He had a great image of being the champion of little folks. But I seem to sense that his motivation was to make Adam a big person. It was a means to an end. It was not the end in itself.
Is this the land of the free and the home of the brave? No! Is this a land with liberty and justice for all? No! Is this one nation, indivisible, under God? No! Either let us practice the democracy we are preaching, or shut up!
Adam Clayton Powell, Baptist minister, leading civil rights activist in Harlem, first black New York City councilman, and now, in 1945, newly elected congressman of the United States, was 12 years older than Hazel. Powell was already married when he and Hazel fell in love. They began a secret affair, and then, just 4 days after his divorce, they married. The Scott Powells were the power couple of the moment. Both were accomplished, admired, and respected in their fields. Both were politically progressive and committed to civil rights. Americans, both black and white, were fascinated with this glamorous, controversial, wealthy, attractive pair. Photographers followed them. The press wrote cover stories about them. They were the most famous black couple in America. Someday he'll come along, the man I love, and he'll be big and strong, the man I love. And when it comes my way, I'll do my best to make him stay. He'll look at me and smile, I'll understand. Then in a little while he'll take my hand. And though it seems absurd, I know we both won't say a word. Maybe I shall meet him someday, maybe Monday, maybe not. Still I'm sure to meet him one day, maybe Tuesday will be my good news day. He'll build a little home that's meant for two, from which I'll never roam. What would you? And so all else above, I'm dreaming of the man I love.
My father's nickname was a Flaming Tongue, and he had heard that people in City Hall, in LaGuardia administration, were very wary of this minister up in Harlem, that he could arouse people, he could bring them down by the subway to City Hall, have a big rally on the steps of City Hall. Things were difficult. Everyone knew times were tough. Who knows what this young minister, this brash young man, might do, this flaming tongue of his. So when he came downtown and talked to LaGuardia and warned about the difficulty of conditions, the frustrations, and how really the conditions were right for a major, major problem in Harlem to suddenly erupt, what he heard back was, yes, we know times are tough, but you may be part of the problem because you're stirring up those people. And so you could just imagine what some of those private meetings were like. And we now can see some of the private correspondence within the LaGuardia administration and between LaGuardia and my father, where there was a great deal of mistrust by the LaGuardia people. What is Powell up to? And there was certainly mistrust on the part of my father. But why isn't City Hall dealing with this?
Congressman Adam Clayton Powell is one of the nation's most sought-after speakers. Behind the dramatic rhetoric, which attracts the crowds, is a 35-year performance as a civil rights activist. Congressman Powell has personally desegregated restaurants and theaters throughout the nation's capital, just by being there.
Black power is merely an attempt of equality of dignity and equality of character and equality of recognition by non-blacks of our negritude. Black power means the saving grace of our United States. The United States no longer is an isolated nation. We're living in a world in which the United States and all of Anglo-Saxon society is in a definite minority. The votes of the black and brown people in the United Nations could turn the United States foreign program upside down in one day. You're in a minority. The soul brothers and the soul sisters, they're in the majority, baby. We're in the majority, and we want you to get in with us before it's too late. Before it's too late. The United States of America is being judged by one unknown, isolated black man or black woman who was senselessly beat to death on the streets of the United States. This is not a great society. This is a sick society. Wherever I've gone, I've had leaders all over the world say, how can you, meaning the United States, expect us to follow you into creating a free world when back in the United States you are clubbing black men and women to death and shooting them down? How can you expect us to do that?
Congressman Powell was born in 1908, yet he finds no generation gap in the struggle for black freedom.
We're black, and black is not the color of your skin. Black is the way you think. In other words, there are a lot of you out there who can think black and still be white. That was taught to us a long time ago by a black Jamaican when I was 10 years old named Marcus Garvey. You call yourselves white, so we want to be called black. It means that we're not anti-white, but we're pro-black. It means we do not believe in violence, but we do not believe in total nonviolence. As my Black Panthers in Harlem, who meet in my church, by the way, each week, say, we are not aggressors, but we are defenders. It means we have black dignity, black integrity, and we want black equality. And we want it now.
He was a leader, born leader, without a doubt. I mean, a born leader, you know. Whenever he spoke, everyone stood up listen.
Yeah, I can't put in words because it's just something else, you know? He's good. In my language, he was a God-sent man.
I shall try to cut my remarks down, but after all, I'm a Negro Baptist preacher, you know. Nobody can control a Negro Baptist preacher. Even God sometimes can. But nevertheless, I will try to make them like a woman's skirt, long enough to be respectable, but short enough to be interesting.
Adam Clayton Powell Jr. was the pastor of America's largest Protestant congregation, a seminal leader in the fight for racial justice, and a U.S. congressman. As a minister, he preferred nightclubs to prayer groups. His political career was dogged by accusations of financial chicanery and neglect of duty, and his motives were often in dispute. But by 1965, he had become the most powerful black man in American political history.
The white liberal was monopolizing the Negro civil rights fight.
That's right. It was plain thing. Plain thing.
And he was allowing into his cartel, his monopoly, only those Negro liberals who would get along with him.
I like the way he thumbed his nose at white folks. Now, I tell you, that spoke to my heart. See, if you've had the black experience in America, it would speak to you.
He was saying things that we had not dared to think. The tone of his speech was one of real defiance, of real anger. It was scary what he was saying, but it was also exhilarating to hear him.
What we know, we know. Rules above, yeah. With a hand of power and a heart of love. And if I'm right, thank God I'm right, he'll fight my battle, and I'll be free someday. Yeah. Therefore, stand together, children. Work together, children. Fight together, children. Work together, children. Pressure together, children. Pull together. Work together, children. Don't you get weary. Faith can't meet in the promise.
But once in a lifetime, a man like that comes along. Once in a lifetime.